Hallo, malty, mountainous mariners, and thank you to William Arnold for that malt mention introducing Whisky Review 556. At Ralphie.com, and here am I in one of my favourite places. You'll have to take my word for that. It's the Manx Bothy, where I sit, peruse, smell, taste, and review for you. And important thing, time. It's making the time, you see, malt mates. And the thing about time is it seems quite simple. It seems quite straightforward, but it's not. It has endless permutations and an ethereal complexity which extends well beyond the perceptiveness of most beings across the universe. That's the thing about time. It gives you no choice, but time does give you options. Right, my option at this moment in time is to review 18-year-old Caol Ila. It's a single malt from Ireland, Scotland. It's bottled at 43%. It's probably chill filtered. In fact, it is chill filtered. And being in a coloured bottle, it's not until you pour the whisky into the glass and have a good look at it that you realise perhaps it's not got a lot of caramel in it. How refreshing. One very simple reason for that is people's perceptions. There's a perception that Ila single malts, with their variable and frequently heavy phenolic character, tend to be lighter in colour. They're not expected to be dark. When they are dark in colour, it's a big surprise, and particularly with age, people rush out to make it a collector's item. Black Bowmore, good example. This isn't Bowmore, this is Caol Ila, another part of the island of Ila, and in my opinion, in many people's opinion, one of the most overlooked and least iconised of Ila's distilleries. Now, this brings an advantage, along with the fact that Ila, Caol Ila, is a large production distillery, and there's a lot of it around. You'll readily find it amongst the independent bottlers without the outrageous price tag that tends to get stuck onto Ardbeg and Bowmore, and occasionally Laphroaig. One of the reasons that people do not associate heavy colour with Ila peated malts, it's very simple, very simple. They don't generally mature the Ila malts in sherry casks. It does happen, but they're predominantly refill ex-bourbon casks, which are perhaps in their second fill, even their third fill. And the reason's simple. If you use a fresh first fill cask, it will proactively influence maturation more extensively at an earlier age. And that can diminish the peatiness, which is the characteristic of many Ila malts. So to use a second fill, third fill ex-bourbon cask means that you have less cask influence, which can be a good thing if it happens to be a mediocre cask. You keep the intense peatiness more intact, because phenolic content in a malt can be remarkably fragile in the warehouse. You know, there's quite a lot of casks after a relatively short space of time can actually lose their peaty nature. And so it just happens to be expectations. People associate peated whiskies from Ila as being light coloured. Good. As soon as I put my nose to this, I'm getting that distinctive Caol Ila briny autumnal fire, bonfire, seaweedy note, a little bit of saltiness in there on the nose. very distinctive, a very substantial character is Caol Ila. And in fact, I've bought many bottles of these over the years, primarily because that they're available at a more accessible price than some single malts from the independent bottlers. And you get some wonderful versions of Caol Ila. Just got to keep your eyes open and keep your research mode online. Keep it nice and up to date. Some honey notes coming through. A little bit of mixed peppers, as in peppercorns. Green pepper, white pepper, a little bit of black pepper in there, giving a touch, a little fennel note with it. You can find fennel, slight licoriciness, can accompany peated whiskies quite regularly. This is actually quite a successful series of casks influencing here. And you're getting the roundness which the producers, through skillful blending of different casks, at 18 years old, they know that a customer who's prepared to pay the money for that bottle is going to have certain expectations as to the experience. And therefore they have to blend, using all single malt from the one distillery, in this case Caol Ila, they have to blend carefully to cater for that expectation. And that's what's happening here. Taste-wise, a good, rich, substantial ginger jam. Sweet. And then sour in the development. Intact phenolic notes, but tempered, rounded. Deliciously so. If there's any shortfall with this malt, it's really in the finish. The finish, after the substance of the arrival and the development, the finish kind of falls away quite quickly into some gentle Lapsang Souchong tea, that kind of dark, bitter tea, China tea note. A little bit of burnt twig, charcoal, very pleasant. And a little bit of slightly over-scorched toffee. I'm not adding a lot of water to this, just a couple of drops, that's all. We stroll around the glass, as we do. So a little bit of pineapple jam, and more slightly overcooked notes, char notes, that bonfire. And yet it's sort of diminished the intensity of that. It's behind this wall of ginger jam, some slight syrup, sultana most definitely, and honey. On the taste, more of an arrival, bigger arrival, prolonged development. More dramatic in the development. The fizziness, the sherbet note in the peat exerting itself more firmly in the development now. It's more prolonged, distinctly more prolonged, and now it's reaching into the finish. So in the case of this whiskey, to add a drop of water is not just changing the array of flavours during the course of the taste experience, but it's actually adding substance to the form. It's starting to fill up and extend the finish of this whiskey. And this is down to the quality of some of the casks contributing to this batch. They're very good. Very good indeed. So what am I going to give this for a malt mark? Ooh. Caol Ila. Right from the very start, one of the first peated whiskies I bought was Caol Ila. I think the second one was as a Bowmore. And as soon as I had my first bad Bowmore, which happened to be a 12-year-old at the time, I started to explore the other Isla single malts. And in fact, the last one I found that I enjoyed very much was Bunahabhan 12-year-old. It used to be a superb, in fact, still is, in fact, as far as I'm aware, because they've got big stocks in the warehouses. Now, let me see. I think I'm going to give this, 88 out of 100. If it had been 46% non-chill filtered, I've given it 90 out of 100. But there we go. Malt Mark, how am I going to give this 90 out of 100? I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to dip into my extensive portfolio of open bottles to a bottle I've bought. Well, I've bought about four or five bottles of this, actually. In fact, I've reviewed this in the past. And this is Gordon MacPhail, Cask Strength, Caol Ila, year 2000. It was distilled, 61.4%. It's a delicious whiskey. This is 43%. It's 18-year-old. This is an 18-year-old, but it's not that far away. This has been chill filtered. This hasn't. I like this, but when I add this to that, I like that even more. It can be a bit daunting when you do it for the first time. The fear is, the fear factor is, this is an 18-year-old whiskey. It's already been blended. Who am I to interfere with the master blender? Well, I'll tell you who you are. You're the customer who bought it, and without you, the distillery wouldn't exist. Show no fear, malt mates. Proceed with your malty madness. I didn't add a drop or two. I added a fairly generous amount of this whisky. And now I'm going to add a drop more water, because I have raised the alcoholic strength by probably at least 5%. And I'm adding a full teaspoonful of water now. It's still a single malt. It's still Caol Ila, because I've added Caol Ila to Caol Ila. This is a great thing to try in whisky clubs. You bring along your own bottle of a certain single malt, and the organiser in the club or amongst friends will bring an older version of that single malt. But you've all chipped in to buy. And then you start to taste the younger stuff through to the older stuff. And then you divide up what's left of the older bottle. And then you start blending for yourself. It's amazing how an older single malt can lift up a younger single malt, can round it off and quite significantly change the form, let alone the flavour. The nose is coming across more dense. There's more confectionery note, ginger, soft ginger, Edinburgh rock, ginger jam. Spices, far more spiciness going on now than in the official bottling on its own. Lime rind, which I haven't tasted, and you'll find this, you will come across notes of smell and perhaps even taste, of taste, which when you combine two single malts, you haven't tasted when you tried them separately. It happens regularly. A more intense, rich, phenolic arrival. The development is quite short at the moment. I can add some more water. I'm getting a note of rhubarb, which I wasn't expecting. I've not done this before, by the way. I do mix my whiskies, but the proportion that you add can have a significant effect. And I've added quite a lot of the independent bottling to the official bottling. And initially, the age presence of the official bottling has been lost. However, experience tells me that it will, given time, start to re-exert itself. And if it doesn't, to the extent I want it to, I can just add a little bit more of this to redress the influence. When you do this, you learn as much about your own palate and sense of smell and taste, malt mates, as you do about the whiskies themselves. Changed again completely. This is a sort of game that can go on all night. It really can. You can do this for hours and hours. Literally one sip, add a drop of something. Another sip, add a drop. Giving it time. 5 minutes, 15 minutes. A little bit of Highland mist, Scotch mist appearing in the glass now due to the fact that the independent bottle has not been chill filtered. So the barley oils and the cask oils and extracts haven't been stripped out. So they're starting to make their appearance. Oh, yes. Yeah. We're meeting in the middle now. I added a drop too much of this in all the excitement, but I've rectified it, rebalanced it with a drop of this, and now the balance is about right. There's a slight perfume note, a slight rye note. Perfumed rye. It's very delicate and it's in amongst the phenolic notes. Quite interesting. Oh yeah. It's like the 18-year-old has been slightly rejuvenated. You're getting the presence of old cask, but you're getting fresher, firmer, lusher. More lush, L-U-S-H, influence of that Caol Ila character. And the development after the arrival is really quite long. At this point, it's becoming very prolonged in the finish. That's how I would describe it. Beautiful stuff, actually. It's the perfect balance of the two. I've got it. Ooh. It really is the best of both worlds. Anyway, I'm going to leave it at that. I've demonstrated something which I highly recommend that you, malt mates, practice, experience, play with. And do with it with a smile and a good chat with friends, a good conversation or some good music playing. Don't take it too seriously. Importantly, you will get better results. You'll get a fuller experience the less you try to analyse it. Just go with it. It's like taking a canoe down the rapids. If you're paddling too much left and right, you're more likely to tip over. Let the river of this malt take you in the journey. Just go down the river with it and enjoy the trip, because it is a trip. A trip in space and time, taste and smell, and the sound of satisfaction. See you later, malt mates.